Good afternoon. And everybody's silent. Awesome. So, I'm actually quite surprised about the turnout here, because I'm apparently competing against Daniel and Jacob. So, I'm going to make a little picture. First of all, wave. Thank you. So, now this is proof. This is proof that most of you are apparently afraid of a burnout. Why is everybody silent? Second picture? Second burnout. Oh, yeah. Wait a second. How young were you?
29.
And you already had a burnout?
I already had a burnout at
29, Whoa. Okay. Actually, that's these days not so uncommon, but yeah, we'll get to that in a few minutes. So this is how not get burned out. So somebody talked to me in person earlier, and he was like, yeah, if you translate this literally to my native language, you get a phrase that basically means how not to get chlamydia. Yeah, so aka how not to get a burnout. So that was those. This is the agenda. It's the agenda's kind of a little bit medical. Systems, cause, problem, solution, resolution, what you have, treatment, what you want to call it. So the number one symptom of a burnout. Any guesses?
Hating people.
What? Hating people?
Yes.
No. That would mean that I've been in a burnout since I was like 6. The number one, by far, insomnia, problem having sleep. The amount of sleep you have is secondary to the quality of sleep. If you're not hitting a REM state, you can sleep for 9, 10, 11 hours and not get a well-rested night. If you have that consistently, you will be tired every single morning and day, then you get irritated. And it's like a domino effect. 9 out of 10 times, it starts with bad sleep. And then people go to the doctor, and the doctor say, hey, you have to have a good bed. So they spend like 6,000 euros on a good bed, and they still have the same problem. So these are most symptoms from a physical or emotional perspective. So anger. It wasn't the most common one, but yeah. Anger is mostly a result of lack of sleep, irritation, etc. Emotionally, and when you have a burnout or you're close to it, you have emotional excesses. You are suddenly extremely sad or extremely angry, and you can't find a cause for that. Maybe it's something very small. For example, I know of a person that was during my psychology education. He was one of our patients, and apparently he was going all out against his wife and children because they forgot to hang a towel in the bathroom. His emotional response to that was so excess, so extreme, he couldn't place it. And it was just a symptom. So then we started, there's an official list of symptoms of a burnout. And so we started checking all of those symptoms. Not all of them, but enough to make an assumption that, hey, maybe you're close to a burnout. We'll get back to that guy, because he wasn't close to burnout. He went through burnouts 3 times and he was still in one. But this one is most common in tech people, specifically. enjoyment in what? Yeah, loss of enjoyment. You can't find joy in anything anymore. For example, I love going to the beach club and having a pina colada. It makes me happy. That's the small things. So I get a laptop with me. I work for a customer. They have Wi-Fi, so I can work anywhere. And in the morning at 10 o'clock, I start with a laptop. And a cola. Yeah. They actually don't start serving pina coladas at 2, until 2. So that was an annoyance, but yeah. Here's the little things. So, especially for IT people, detachment or beta people is not uncommon, even isolation. But there's a phrase, it goes, how do you translate it to English? Yeah. The fact that you're alone doesn't mean that you're lonely. Some people like to be alone. They only find other people pretty much annoying. But they're not lonely at all. So, pessimism. Some people are this by nature. They always see the glass half empty. And yeah, you can say the glass is always full because of air and blah, blah, blah. The glass is half too big. Than it needs to be. Actually, we had one of those guys in our classroom. He actually started arguing with us because of that freaking glass. Because according to him, it was just 2 times as big as it needed to be. You have a word for that. It's called a smart ass. So, another symptom is basically ineffectiveness, or at least you feel like you are not having any effect. And because of that, you don't have a sense of accomplishment. Let's say, for example, that you build an entire Hyper-V cluster. And you did it in a record time. Okay. No enjoyment of it, no sense of success or whatever. There are many causes to that, and 9 out of 10 times it is that bad behavior is punished, good behavior is normal. So you're not saying anything about it, it's good behavior. And that's also something managers can learn from. Good behavior can also be rewarded. Not always financially, but just say, hey, thank you. It's the easy things. But from that perspective, grown-up people are almost like children. The same thing, the same criteria apply in that regard. So, this is 9 out of 10 times the main cause. Inequality. So, I don't mean that men versus women, or young versus old, or colored versus uncolored. What I mean is that you see that you're treated unequally to others. Or you think that you're treated unequally. 9 out of 10 times, that's a cause. That's a root cause of getting a burnout. Also, that's the cause. This is the main problem. No balance. So, who has ever worked 60, 70 hours a week? Of those hands. No, I'm getting back to that. No, of those hands, who has ever been in a burnout? Who has ever been in a burnout of those hands? If you're in doubt, the answer is yes. So when the balance is gone, you're demanding so much of yourself. Each person has a critical mass. They can only do so much and then it's their normal state. Let's say, for example, their productivity has a value of 80. But yeah, there's a problem now. You have to work at a productivity level of 120 instead of 80. So 150%. You can do that a week, two, maybe even a month. But if you have to do that consistently for half a year, you will break. Easy peasy. This is the main solution. Get a balance.
Two jobs.
Okay. When do you have time for an appointment? So, balance, creating balance is apparently really difficult. In my case, I'm a workaholic. I love to work. So I'm really sensitive for getting a burnout. Because if you're a workaholic, you probably will not have the reflection, like, hey, am I still doing what's right for me? Probably not, if you're a workaholic. Unless, and I found that out pretty recently, like partners. If you have a girlfriend, if you have a wife, even if you have children, they will probably say something like, hello, attention. So once you have a balance, you found the balance again, it is pretty easy to fall down again, to get a burnout again. So steady your feet. Ask your colleagues to keep an eye out on you. Ask your wife. She'll probably do it anyway, but the problem with most men specifically is vulnerability. Asking for help, most men don't do it like that. Especially burnout, getting a burnout for most men feels like I can't do that. That's not masculine. A burnout, that's for weak people. I'm 33 years old now, and the generation before me was raised that way. You don't get a burnout. You go through it. You work. On the other hand, there now is a generation that you have to do this and they have a burnout. I even saw a TEDx talk where the person said, basically, we're raising a bunch of pussies. Yeah, pretty much correct. It has multiple reasons. One of them, I think, is they don't know how to handle criticism. Who has ever learned how to accept a compliment? Three people? Yeah, you count for six. So that's it. How do you receive a compliment? Any takers? Yeah, it's a two-way street. But let's say I say like, "Hey, you have a pretty nice shaven beard." Well done. You have to
register it as a compliment.
That's all.
That's the first step.
That's the first step, sure. You have to accept it, register it. So, 9 out of 10 times, the result is thank you. Some people even start blushing and are sorry, thank you. But, that's something a lot of people don't learn. Not at school, definitely not at home. Because, hey, if I don't have a brother, but I had friends that had brothers, they're not giving little brothers compliments. And little brothers are not giving big brothers compliments. They tease each other. Some people call it teasing, I call it something else. But so ask your colleagues for assistance in this. 9 out of 10 times, especially in the Netherlands, companies have persons you can, I don't know how to translate, but something like a counselor, in-house counselor, where you can basically say, hey, I feel I'm getting overworked again. And also, go to your manager. Go to the cause. Who is making you do all those hours? In my experience, there were project leaders. Because they can't plan for shit. And every single time they can't hit the deadline, I have to make extra hours. So there's a phrase. A lack of planning on your part does not constitute in an emergency on mine. Hear, hear? Yeah, it's an epic saying, sure. But that's... They can be the cause, but you can be the resolution. Sure, once or twice, but if it's consistently, remove the problem. I don't mean that you have to take a knife and get it to their throat or something, but you can say no. The problem is with operational people, they are willing to help. It's most of us, it's in our nature. And what?
It's in my contract.
It's in your contract. You always say yes?
No, but when I say no, probably my boss is. Do it anyway.
Yeah, but if it's reasonable, sure. If it's like an emergency, sure. But if it's consistently, I don't know if how the market is in your country, but if any IT person is handled that way in the Netherlands, they have a new job like this. Right now, we're spoiled like that. So, I always say, treat others like you want to be treated. And some managers, some employers forget that. On the other hand, promises have been made to customers. There's a delivery date. You have to do that. Again, once or twice, not a problem. But solve the root cause. If some people can't plan, make better plannings. If that person really can't plan, let him make the first planning and let somebody else review it. And my personal belief, keep people accountable. If they fuck up, they need to, not pay, but they need to feel the pain. Who has ever had a customer where, or an employer, hey, we've bought an IT application. Hey, IT, do it. I see like 10 hands, that's it? Okay. So that is pretty normal. And in the Netherlands, more and more C-level gets an IT person on that level, a CTO. Not necessarily technical, but he is the voice from the IT department at that level. It helps. The whole DevOps thing, like talking together, making planning together, it helps. For me, Agile, it's awesome. I love a sprint. Because I know exactly how many resources I have, how many work we can accomplish based on those resources. And we give a commitment to our customers like that. And then our manager comes along and Danny, where are you? Yeah. You know a certain manager at a customer we were both at. We have a sprint. It's full. And he is 2 days into the sprint. He's like, oh, no, I want this and this done. Which takes like 2 people, 3 days to do it. No, we have a full sprint. And he was like, no, I don't think you understand me. I want this done. You're doing it. And what you said, I'm getting overruled like that. But then, who is the problem? Am I the problem? Is the team the problem? Or is that manager the problem? Because the manager made promises to customers without consulting us. That's why it's an urgency for him. And I was like, sure, not a problem. This is the list of our current sprint. You decide what to take out and you can contact the customers. Good luck. Make people accountable. Good.
You just talked about balance.
Yeah.
But also making people fuck up to the
thing. Yeah, yeah.
So how do you keep those two in balance? Because if you do that all the time, then your colleagues will really try not to make mistakes. And that's not really DevOps.
Correct. Making mistakes isn't bad. But if you're not learning from your mistakes, that's bad. And DevOps, sorry that I'm not going to say it, but DevOps smash ops, if people aren't learning from their mistakes, I don't want them as a colleague.
Yeah, but you do that repeated mistake, not that first one.
Correct.
Yeah, okay, that's a new one.
Yeah. So if they make a mistake once, oops. If they make the mistake twice, really, dude, seriously. If they do it three times, we need to have a talk. So one of the things I go to customers and I talk about scripting, DevOps. And there's a thing, but most admins, they're like, yeah, scripting is scary. Especially the Windows admins, they're spoiled. They like to click. Yeah. So I want to play a game. Who has a laptop with him, open? I see a few people not with their hands up, so you're screwed. Anybody else that has pen and paper, get it. Anybody else that has a laptop, open something like Paint or whatever. If you have a stylus, get your stylus. We're going to play a little game, and it's going to be fun, trust me. So what we're going to do, you're going to have 60 seconds for an exercise. And after the exercise, I'll explain what it's about, because there's a method to the madness here. The exercise is, take a good look at the person next to you, left or right, I don't care, pick one. That person, look at him or her. Yeah? So, that person, you have 60 seconds to draw their face. Go. Three, four, five, six, seven. Draw their face, not make a picture. Hey, you weren't supposed to draw me. Thirty seconds have passed. You're halfway there. Forty-five seconds have passed. 15 seconds left. 10 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, done. Stop. Now, here comes the fun part. Take your drawing and show it to the person you've drawn. Okay, and now the method to the madness. Who was laughing? That's it? Come on, be honest. Who was laughing? Okay. Why? What? You don't have paper?
Yeah, I would have done it.
Okay, anybody who did make a drawing on their laptop or whatever, why were you laughing? You were trying something you weren't good at.
And it was horrible.
And it was horrible. Why? Why was it horrible?
Because I have no stylus and I can't draw.
You don't have a stylus and you can't draw. So I've given you an exercise without knowing your technical skills, giving you bad equipment, and you still manage to do it. But based on the equipment you have, on your skills, and on the time I gave you, do you think you could have done better? Maybe. Do you think you could have done a lot better?
Not the first time.
Okay, that's the right answer. I gave you an exercise in a very short amount of time, not knowing your technical skills, your drawing skills. I gave you pretty bad equipment for this task. And still you got the thing done. So how many times did you have to write a script? Or did you had to do something with bad equipment in a certain amount of time? It was a task you've never done before. Nobody? Yeah. It happens quite often, actually. So, if you're laughing, most of the people are like, sorry. Why are you apologizing? Seriously. You have done this, etc., with the criteria I mentioned, be proud of it. If you ask a small child to do this, and they do this in elementary school, they come home and look, Daddy, I made a drawing. It's terrible. But they're proud of it. So it is learned behavior to apologize. Again, the criteria are set. This is the best you can do based on these criteria, based on the equipment you have, the current skill. What the manager is going to say, this is bad work. This is terrible. Do better. Now, we're calling this an MVP, minimum viable product. Sure. Because you need to figure it out. But then the manager is like, nope, we're running production now. On to the next project. And you're like, but I know I need to fix stuff there. And you're not getting the chance to fix it. You need to continue. So my message here is, whatever people say, if you reflect upon this and you could not have done better based on these criteria, be proud of it. You've done your best. That's all people can ask. Do your best. Next time, you can probably do it better. You learn. Exercise makes perfect.
The problem with pride, you probably
the problem with what?
Pride is, if I would be proud of this, I probably someday will think that I could draw and show someone, and they will probably don't.
Yeah, because again, you're probably you're saying you're tough to be proud of it, because if you show it to other people, then they'll probably tell you it's pretty bad. But if you explain to them, hey, these are the criteria I got, 60 seconds, etc., etc., and if they don't trust you, make them do it themselves. So this is one of the things that can help you. The other one is rest. If you can't get sleep for whatever reason, take rest when and where you can. Well, I have to fly quite a lot for my work. And I've got a luxury that I can sleep pretty much anywhere. I've always had that. So mostly I take off from Schiphol Airport in Amsterdam. And we're on the start lane. We're powering up the engines, and there we go. And before we are at cruising altitude, I'm fast asleep. For me, the luxury, I get on the plane, we're on the starting lane, and I'm like, and I can sleep. So I have a sign around my neck, let me sleep. Because those lovely ladies from the flight the stewardess ladies. I had that once. I had to fly to Vegas and she was like, sir, sir, do you want something to drink? I was like, no, you stupid. I wanted to sleep. what most people don't know in case of planes, you can just sleep. They let you sleep. And when you wake up, you can give them a sign and you get your drink or your food or whatever. So take rest when and where you can. Jeffrey Snover is an expert in this. I found out a few hours ago. I'm actually pretty bummed he isn't in this session because that would have been awesome. And tag him on Twitter. Oh, yeah. So that's a tool. Take rest when and where you can. Like I said, colleagues or partners, or even if you have a decent amount of self-reflection, you can do it yourself. Every month, because I have my own company, every month I've got a day where I pay the salaries. Pretty straightforward. I use that day for reflection purposes. Am I still doing the right thing? Not only from a business perspective, but also personal. Are there perhaps new projects I want to pick up? Stuff like that. So again, make yourself confident about the stuff you do. It's not bad. Can be better, probably. Candy? But now I'm distracted. I see candy. So, what somebody there said, DevOps. No fear to fail. Failure is natural. You learn from your mistakes. If you don't, get out. So, one of the things was at a customer where we build a continuous delivery pipeline. And our developers had a manager, and that manager was very kind to me because I built the pipeline. And the pipeline showed him how many builds were failing each day. And he even got a tool he installed without me knowing it that showed him the top build failures. Not the cause of the failure, who failed it. And there had a number behind it every week. So, hey, if you're the top build failure, he's talking to you on Monday. He's talking to you. Like, what you doing? Why are you breaking the builds? If you continue like this, we're going to have a performance review. The result of this is that all the developers were getting scared to check in their code. Their productivity dropped dramatically. They went from 100% productivity up to something like 30, 25%. Because they were scared of checking in the code. They were running the tests locally. Why? I built a freaking pipeline to do your tests. Check in the code, done. If it fails, it's not going to production anyway. So I gave the manager a new metric. The amount of time a developer that breaks a build needs to fix it. That's a good metric. Again, talking to that person, if he's consistently in the top build failure, not the metric you want to know. If he's consistently taking longest to fix his build, talk to the team. Because 9 out of 10 times, the manager can't evaluate why. Maybe it's extremely difficult what the guy's doing. So, this is one that helped me personally. This is my main cause why I will not get a burnout. Who recognizes this? Shush, not you, you know it already. Nobody? One, two. Any more? Really? No? Who thinks it's about this guy? Ultron. The Avengers. He stole it. It's from Pinocchio. You know, the guy with the nose when he was lying? So, there are no strings on me. People can ask me to do something. They can't tell me. Same for you. People can't make you do anything. You will always have a choice. You can say no, perhaps lose your job. It is a possible choice. You just have to weigh the options. If you're consistently overruled and you're getting being the victim, not feeling the victim, but actually being the victim, then, hey, remove your strings. Candy? Yeah, sure. Ooh, goody. Thank you. Now I feel in high school again. Pass it around. So the summary, basically, recognize the symptoms. That's step one, always. Only when you think you have all the symptoms, then you can draw a conclusion. From the symptoms, you derive the problem. From the problem, you derive the cause. From the cause, you derive the... Again? From the cause comes the... What? Resolution or treatment. Yeah. And try the treatment. Try the resolution. If it doesn't work, go back. Have you gotten all the symptoms? Etc. Troubleshooting in IT, 9 out of 10 times they start troubleshooting, they start trying things when all the symptoms aren't known yet. I've been at a customer where you're working. We had a war room a few times where stuff was really going wrong in the infrastructure. And they already started troubleshooting. My first question was why? The problem was created, or we found out, half an hour ago. Why are we already trying to... Hey, is it here? What if we put out, yank out this cable? Stuff like that. First, the symptoms, then the actions. So use the tools. And if you're not the person almost hitting a burnout, but if it's a colleague, help them. If they're afraid to ask, offer help. If you can't help, don't meddle with it. You're only getting in the way. Nine out of 10 times, when it comes to stuff like this, people need to trust you. And there are a lot of people that are willing to help, but don't have the trust of the, lack of a better word, patient. Trust of the colleague. So I hope you liked it. I hope you're not getting a burnout again, maybe. If you have any questions, I'll be available for the rest of this day and tomorrow. And apparently this evening we have speaker dinner, so yeah, Twitter will be better by then. So these are the next steps, especially number 2, grab some coffee.